Hi, in this video I'm going to talk about my favourite band, Evanescence. I'm going to give you some background information about the band and their journey. I'm going to talk about how I got into them, and I'll also give brief reviews of their albums and discuss some of my favourite tracks. Evanescence was formed in Little Rock, Arkansas in the USA in 1995 by Amy Lee and Ben Moody. There's a lot of discussion over the genre of the band. Personally, I consider them metal, with their later music transitioning to hard rock. However, some people call them gothic metal, emo, and Christian, among other things. I don't think any of these three terms are accurate. I will admit that their second album tends toward a more gothic style, but they're definitely not emo, and the band have stated themselves that while some of their members believe in God, they do not consider themselves a Christian band. In 1994, at a youth camp, Ben overheard Amy playing a Meatloaf song on the piano, and this is how the two founders met and began writing their first songs. Solitude, Give Unto Me, Understanding, and My Mortal, a track which managed to earn a place on their future debut album. Some early ideas for band names were Childish Intentions and Stricken, but they ended up settling on Evanescence, which means disappearing, vanishing, or fading. They released two EPs, Evanescence EP in 1998 and Sound Asleep EP in 1999. They also released a full-length demo CD in 2000 called Origin, which contains some really beautiful music including some brilliant instrumentals, but is extremely rare. However, Amy and Ben both encouraged fans to download Origin and the EPs off the internet rather than buying them, since they felt that they weren't worth the money, having only been written when the two were teenagers. After the band got signed for the first time, they began working on their debut album called Fallen. Originally, the record label were refusing to ever release Fallen unless the band added a permanent male co-vocalist, but Evanescence didn't want to do this. They compromised by having Paul McCoy from 12 Stones feature on the lead single, Bring Me To Life. The band's lineup was eventually completed by Amy and Ben's friends, John LeCompte, Rocky Gray, and Will Boyd, who helped to write Fallen, which I'll now talk about in more detail. This is Evanescence's debut album, Fallen. I like the colours on the album art. I think the dark blues and the blacks really set the mood for the songs. The disc itself is quite nice too. It has a sort of gothic look to it. It's simple, but it's nice. And here's the track list. Going Under, Bring Me To Life, Everybody's Fool, My Immortal, Haunted, Tourniquet, Imaginary, Taking Over Me, Hello, My Last Breath, and Whisper. It's not listed, but there's also a hidden 12th track, which is a version of My Immortal with the whole band playing, and it's normally just a piano ballad. One of my favourite tracks from Fallen is Haunted. It has a really dark sound to it, and it combines heavy guitars with synthesised effects, and appropriately features a really haunting vocal line with a choir near the end. It also has, in my opinion, one of the greatest guitar solos in the album. For me, the lyrics are about being brought down by the negative influence of someone we love. We know we need to escape, but our love keeps us there. Even if we did escape, we wouldn't truly be free, since our memories will have been tainted by trauma and pain. It's a really powerful song. Another of my favourite Fallen tracks is Imaginary. This track had been around since Origin, and is the Evanescence song with the most different versions at 7. The two most well-known versions are the Origin version and the Fallen version. In fact, when I first became an Evanescence fan, I mistakenly believed that the Origin version was the official version for about a year or so, which is embarrassing. While I do prefer the Origin version, I've developed a different love for the Fallen version. It just sounds better produced in my opinion. Both versions have really gorgeous lyrics and deal with a place to escape to when you can't cope with real life troubles. Interestingly, Haunted, Tourniquet and Imaginary come back to back on the album and are all in the same key. The instrumentation of each track sounds quite similar too, so I think there may be a hidden connection between these tracks. The fact that Tourniquet ends on a long, slow string passage and Imaginary starts with strings too further backs up the idea of a connection. On the 22nd of October 2003, Ben Moody left the band because of apparent creative differences. According to Amy, Ben was more focused on the commercial aspect of things, whilst she herself was more focused on creativity and writing music that they enjoy, rather than writing to please others. So, after losing their guitarist in the middle of the tour, Terry Balsamo stepped up and became Evanescence's new guitarist. Terry was a member of Limp Bizkit in their early days, but is better known as the guitarist from Cold. He's my favourite of Evanescence's guitarists. His influence on Evanescence's music is really apparent, and he co-wrote the band's sophomore album with Amy. This album is called The Open Door, and I'll talk more about that now. This is the second album, The Open Door. This is my favourite Evanescence album. The album art features a large disproportionate doorway leading to a cloudy sky, with Amy facing into it but with her head facing back over her shoulder. She's wearing a lovely long flowing dress which she created herself. I like the black and gold theme of the album and the thorns surrounding the album name. The disc is interesting. It's dark blue with a golden rim. There's a lighter sun-like design around the centre, and the track names are printed in gold around the circumference. And on the back of the leaflet here is a gorgeous version of the band's logo, themed for the album. The tracks are Sweet Sacrifice, Call Me When You're Sober, Weight of the World, Lithium, Cloud Nine, Snow White Queen, Lacrimosa, Like You, Lose Control, The Only One, Your Star, All the Time Living For, and Good Enough. Because The Open Door is my favourite album, I could talk for hours about all of the tracks and how much I love them, so I'm just going to talk about some noteworthy tracks in no great detail, and then my number one favourite track. Sweet Sacrifice is a really strong and memorable opening track, and my favourite of Evanescence's opening tracks. It has some really nice guitar work and showcases Amy's vocal range and techniques really well. Weight of the World is a very unique track with regards to its tonality and instrumentation. It has some heavy guitar riffs, but the first section of the song also features a solo metallophone. Its lyrics are about pressure and wanting to be let go. Lithium is one of the most popular tracks from the album and one I particularly enjoy playing on piano. I have a video of me playing along to the song, so just click here if you'd like to watch that. It's a lovely track that begins as a sorrowful piano ballad, but then gets thickened up by heavy guitars. The verses have acoustic guitar, so they have a calmer feel. Lyrically, the song is undoubtedly about depression, anxiety, and self-doubt. The music video features Amy playing grand piano in the snow, and it's just a stunning video overall. I'd highly recommend watching it. Cloud Nine is another outstanding track. It's very unique, like most of the songs on The Open Door, and makes good use of interesting harmonies and has one of my favourite bridges of all time. Lacrimosa is a very interesting track. It is based off of Mozart's Lacrimosa from his Requiem Mass in D minor and is full of strings and a Latin singing choir. It is the only song on the album in triple time, which makes a nice contrast and makes the track very memorable. Its lyrics talk about blame and change. Lose Control is another favourite. Its key is never fully apparent as it is constantly shifting around, but it is pulled off so flawlessly and I admire it so much. It has an eerie feel to it, features Amy whispering during the chorus. The bridge really breaks everything down, slow drums and almost no backing. It still makes me feel like my heart stops when I get to this dramatic section. Overall, a great track. I've gone on so much about this album already, but lastly is my all-time favourite Evanescence song, Good Enough. It's a beautiful piano ballad with some of the most heartfelt lyrics and tender piano playing I have ever heard. It has an introduction over 1 minute long, but that's okay because it makes the song seem like a journey, which lyrically it is. The verses are major, which is a surprising contrast to an otherwise dark album, and the lyrics are astounding. They pretty much talk about being a complete fool in love and being willing to do everything and anything for that one person. The song begs the question, am I good enough? And Amy's voice definitely does justice to the intricacy of the melody. It's a bit of an emotional roller coaster, but all in all, it's a happy song. Evanescence underwent many gradual lineup changes between their second and third album, and also took a painstaking 5-year hiatus. Instead of going through each individual lineup change, I'm just going to summarise the overall change. You can read the details on the Evanescence reference by clicking on the link in the description. By this point, Amy was the only remaining member of the original Evanescence lineup, and this has resulted in many fans disputing over the essence of Evanescence. Is Amy herself what makes Evanescence? It's now a long debated topic I won't discuss now, but I may make a video about it in the future. Anyway, Evanescence's lineup was now Amy, Terry, and three new guys: Tim McCord on bass, Troy McLaughlin on rhythm guitar, and Will Hunt on drums. It was this quintet who wrote Evanescence's third album, which was self-titled. This symbolises a lot. It gives a sense of solidarity and, according to Amy, represents the true nature of Evanescence. Also, it's a very fitting title since the band made a point of the music being written by the whole band rather than being 99% co-written by Amy and Terry themselves. So basically, it was a team effort and the results were pretty good. Here is Evanescence, sometimes known amongst fans as Ev3. This is the special edition and is the only Evanescence album to have one. It comes in this lovely and shiny paper case and has four bonus tracks along with a DVD. The DVD features the lead single's music video and its making, along with some behind the scenes footage and discussion of the tracks on the album. As for the art, Amy thought it would be best to have no photos in the album art so that it seemed more mysterious and more about the band and less about herself. The band's name is placed right in the centre and surrounded by a cloud of purple, blue and white light which fades away the further from the centre it goes. Amy said this effect represents the meaning of the word Evanescence. Evanescence is also written backwards at the very bottom of the artwork in purples and blues. This particular album was gifted to me by one of my dearest friends who I've known for a few years now. We've stuck by each other through a lot of hard times, and I'm so thankful to have such a dear friend as her. She knows who she is. Anyway, inside the cover is a nice shot of the band all together. I like Amy's dress. And here is the disc. It's very plain, but not in a bad way. It's the same symbolism as on the album artwork, and Evanescence is written around the circumference of the disc. Really nice. The booklet inside also contains some really lovely photographs of the band and ones of Amy on her own. There's a certain one I really like where she is in a desert and she's holding onto some rocks while wearing this stunning purple eyeshadow and silver nail polish. It's just a nice picture. So here are the tracks: What You Want, which was their big comeback single, Made of Stone, The Change, My Heart is Broken, The Other Side, Erase This, Lost in Paradise, Sick, End of the Dream, Oceans, Never Go Back, Swimming Home, New Way to Bleed, Say You Will, Disappear, and Secret Door. The pre-order edition from iTunes also had a 17th track, which was a remix of What You Want, but I honestly didn't like it. I'm not a fan of remixes. But 16 tracks is more than enough anyway, and that's more than on either of the first two albums. My initial favourite track from the album was The Change. It starts out quite mellow with some calming harmonies and dreamy vocals, but the guitars get heavier throughout the track. The chorus is really catchy, which I find interesting because the lyrics are actually quite sad. They deal with deception and obviously change. The bridge is strong and contains lyrics which I actually use as my first Twitter username: You Changed and I'm a Liar by Your Side. There was an acoustic performance of this song done in Germany. It's lovely, and that coming from someone who doesn't normally write acoustic versions, it's a popular track among most fans. The Other Side brings one word to mind: groovy. That sounds quite cringy, but honestly I just want to get up and move when I hear it. It has some of the best drum work in their entire discography in my opinion, and the bass is fantastic too. It has some interesting harmonies and a lovely piano section in the bridge. The lyrics are about death, but not in a depressing sort of way. Amy sort of takes the negativity of the concept and overpowers it with this sort of strange positive outlook, for lack of a better way of putting it. I could be completely wrong there, but that's what the lyrics mean to me. Another of my favourites from the album is Oceans. It's packed full of lovely smooth synths and great bass work, along with some really rocking guitar riffs. The song starts with synthesizer sounds making nice harmonies which lead Amy in. Then the bass and drums join in and eventually the whole band is playing. The chorus is really catchy with really cool sounding backing vocals providing a sort of counter melody. And at the end of the bridge the song comes to a complete stop for about one beat, and then when the music starts again it really packs a punch. I think the lyrics can be interpreted in many different ways, since it's mostly metaphorical, but for me the song is about finding strength and courage we didn't know we had. Even when the challenge seems too great, we have power inside us that we have to have faith in. Disappear is the second last bonus track and is amazing live. Its catchy guitar riff and nostalgic piano theme make a great combination. Add speed and continuity to that and you have a fan favourite. There's just something about this one song that everybody loves. I don't know anyone who dislikes this song. I think the lyrics are about being in love with someone who doesn't make an effort to love you back. I don't know what it means for everybody else, but it's clear to me that that's what they mean to me. Some other noteworthy tracks on the album, followed by one word which summarises them: Made of Stone, Sassy, Lost in Paradise, Cry, Sick, Catchy, Swimming Home, Canning, and Say You Will, Super Sassy. The album really has to be listened to in its entirety to fully appreciate it, though Nothing Wrong With My Heart Is Broken, Erase This, End of the Dream, Never Go Back, New Way to Bleed, and Secret Door, just saying. Now I'm going to talk briefly about how I got into Evanescence. Before I started listening to metal, I used to listen to all the rubbish that's in the pop charts. I hate remembering that, but it's the truth. Then one Christmas, my parents got me Band Hero for the Xbox 360, and of course, in that game is featured Bring Me to Life. So I heard that for the first time, and I liked it, so I kept playing it over and over. Then I found out that my girlfriend at the time liked it too, and also listened to some other Evanescence songs. So she let me hear them, and I swear that's when my life changed for the better. I was so inspired by them, I ended up liking Evanescence more than she did, and went through a phase of obsession, which isn't really over, so I guess it wasn't really a phase. If I remember correctly, it was 2010, so I only had 1 year of the hiatus to endure before F3 was released in 2011. I still remember the day the album came out. I had pre-ordered it on iTunes and I was just awestruck for weeks. It was just before the release that I began using Twitter and I began to discover some other Evanescence fans on there. So then I became a part of the massive network of Evanescence fans online and I felt like I belonged. Then I noticed my fellow fans mentioning other bands in their tweets, so I checked them out and turns out I got converted and started loving metal and rock. I think the first band after Evanescence was Hailstorm, and then it all starts to branch out like a food web of how I discovered all these bands. I've never looked back, and I'm so glad that Evanescence's music entered my life because it has helped me through some tough times and inspired me in ways that I cannot even begin to describe. Well, thanks for watching and I hope you enjoyed the video. If you're already an Evanescence fan, please let me know in the comments whether you agree with my opinions and favourite songs. And if you're not a fan yet, hopefully I have inspired you to go and give them a listen. I promise you won't regret it if you do. See you next time.